morning. My name is Jerry Guyve, and I work at the Office of Materials and Road Research in the research section. I'd like to introduce our topic for today. Our speaker is Deborah Odie Ghosh. She's a fairly new employee with MnDOT, started in January of this year and recently completed her PhD thesis. She's going to tell us about the effects of biosealants or rejuvenators on asphalt binder and mixture properties. This was a joint study between MnDOT and the University of Minnesota. The field performance and mechanical properties of the asphalt mixtures from pavement sections treated with a number of new products called biosealants was investigated. Laboratory testing was performed on treated asphalt binder and mixtures, and she's going to explain what she did. Please welcome Deborah Odie Ghosh.
Good morning. Thank you for being here today. Today I'm going to tell something about the effects of biosealants or rejuvenators on asphalt binder and mixture properties. So biosealants and rejuvenators can be used in a different way, like before the paving during production, or sometimes as surface treatments for pavement preservation. Today I'm going to focus the effect of these products for surface treatment as pavement preservation. Here is an outline. Initially, I will tell something about the significance of the study, the objective, the research approaches we took to fulfill our objective, some literature review where others have performed similar studies, materials and methodologies, experimental analysis, and result in discussion. Here is an introduction for the project we did. So these new products, sometimes called biofoxyl or biosealant or oil-based rejuvenator, those were applied as surface treatment on our Wright County Road. The road was constructed in 2013 and the products were applied in 2014. And then every year the pavement performance in terms of distress surveys was performed, and then the pavement performance was recorded. So in this study, we will talk a little bit about replay, bi-rester, joint bond, and as a comparison, we also did an investigation on traditional asphalt sealant, CSS1E. The significance of the study: as we all know, that pavement preservation is much more efficient than pavement rehabilitation and reconstruction. So, and also surface treatment represents a major component of pavement preservation. But it's always challenging to choose appropriate products for this technique, and some new products always keep emerging in the field or in the market. So we need some standard, or we need some idea or testing method to get the idea of its performance before we go to the expensive field study. The manufacturer always keep claiming that these biosealants penetrate the surface of the asphalt pavement and rejuvenate the aging of the asphalt binder, and thus it reverses the oxidation process. So laboratory evaluation of these new products is always important, because we need to get an idea like how it should work in the actual field. So there are no research efforts investigating the effect of this product currently on asphalt materials. So that gives our objective, like how we can test them, or how we can get the idea of what type of effects it has on binder and also on mixture. So the objective is understand and quantify the effects of applying biosealants or rejuvenator on asphalt material properties that can lead to improvements in pavement performance. Investigate if field conditions can be reasonably reproduced in the laboratory conditions, and determine that if they are more effective than traditional asphalt sealants like CSS1H, which we use traditionally. So the research approach, we did some literature review, and then we tried to develop a sample preparation method that can mimic the spray application in the field. And then we obtained core from the actual treated and untreated sections, and we tested them in the laboratory. And also, we tested the effects of this sealant on binder in the laboratory. And then we tried to correlate the laboratory findings with the pavement performance. So for the literature review, here is a little bit of summary, but we have understood, like the other researchers have performed, that oil-based rejuvenators have a significant softening effect, and it reduces rotting resistance and also lower the viscosity. Application of sealants depend on the environment, cost, and the needs to be addressed at the right moment. Cold temperature regions face more challenges in choosing suitable sealants because of their freeze-thaw cycle, short and relatively cold construction period, snow and ice removal operation. All states have developed their guidelines, so there are no hard rule for that's followed by all the states. They have their own guidelines that when this pavement maintenance techniques should be performed and how they will be performed. A study by Al-Khadi described that the sealant with an appropriate consistency at the recommended installation temperature would provide better effectiveness and would ensure appropriate bond strength. There he presented some study that the temperature is really important when you apply the sealant. A field study by PennDOT on replay. This replay is a product that also we studied. So the PennDOT also did a study on this replay, and they concluded that there was no effect visible of the sealant application after 18 months. But the manufacturer of the replay claims that it penetrated 0.75 inches to 1.25 inch, and once in 3 to 5 years, it can add 5 years of service life. Also, we did some study on joint bond, and that was also performed by Maine DOT. So they concluded that joint bond may minimize asphalt maintenance by penetrating newly placed asphalt pavement and stabilizing the critical areas surrounding longitudinal construction joint. Tennessee DOT also did some research on joint bond and concluded that it can be used as a fix when the contractors do not meet the joint density requirements. The treatment was also applied to two test sections of Trans-Highway 95 in Minnesota in 2008, and no noticeable performance difference between treated and untreated section was found in 2009. So there are some, like always some controversies, like how these products are performing, so we need some idea beforehand before going to the expensive field study. So this is the picture I showed earlier. This is the construction site, and we obtained core from the treated sections for mixture testing, and we also tested the effect of these products on the binder PG15-28. These are the application rates for the treated sections. The number of cores 3+1 means that first that these 3 cores from each treated sections were obtained after 3 weeks of sealant application, and then we wanted to get the idea like how it performed over time. So we obtained 1 core from each treated sections, also from the control section after 8 months of sealant application, so that we can run a comparison between 3 weeks, after 3 weeks and after 8 months. This is an initial, this is the field performance. So this is a transverse crack per mile, and those distance survey was performed every year since the sealant application in 2014, 2015, and 2016. As you can see that the replay and bio raster, the bio 1 and bio 2 represents 2 different application rates for bio raster. The replay and bio raster are basically the oil-based rejuvenator. They had less cracking compared to joint bond and CSS 1 each. However, since this is a 1-year-old pavement when they were applied, so it's kind of better to compare the crack growth rate after the treatment because they might have some pre-existing crack when the sealants were applied. So here when we did this transverse cracking, the crack growth, like cracks per mile per year, compared to the control section, it was observed that the replay treated section and the CSS 1H, which is the traditional sealant, previous section observed the highest plant growth rate over years compared to the others previous section. So now our idea is like how we can reproduce or get the idea like in the laboratory, through laboratory investigation, that how it's having an effect on mixture and binder properties. So we did the binder testing. We did typical testing of GSR testing for high temperature, intermediate temperature, and BVA testing for low temperature. So for with the DSR, we got wetting parameter and fatigue parameter, and with BVA testing, we got the low temperature critical stiffness and realization properties. We ran out for PT15-28, we ran the frequency sweep test from 4 degrees Celsius to 70 degrees Celsius, and bending beam rheometer test was performed at two different temperatures, which is minus 18 degrees Celsius and minus 24 degrees Celsius, to obtain the true grading of the binder. Now the sample preparation method. So based on other studies that have been performed earlier, we mixed the bind sealant with a hot binder. We heated the binder at 160 degrees Celsius, and then we added the sealant at 4% of the binder wet. This 4% was obtained based on the application wet of the sealant in the actual field, and then we back calculate and did the analysis to get this 4%. But if we mix the sealant with hot binder, it gives us 100% blending, but that's not the case in the actual field, because in the actual field, we spray the sealant and we expect it to penetrate, and then based on its penetration, it would rejuvenate the mixture properties or the binder properties. So we try to simulate that in the field, in the lab, and then we try to prepare the sample first and then spray the sample with these rejuvenators or the sealants. But since the sample area is so small, it was kind of distorting the sample geometry. And then we tried to apply it by brushing, but it still didn't help because it was kind of destroying the sample surface. And then we tried using a pipette, because with pipette, we can control the application of sealant with drops. And since it's a measuring pipette, we can measure the density and the weight of one drop. So we measured the density of all the sealants in the laboratory, and then based on the penetration amount from the literature and field application rate from the construction record, we were able to calculate the weight of one drop and then calculate the number of drops that's needed based on the surface area, and that will simulate the field application rate. And then we used a non-absorbent plastic strip to spread the sealant over the sample surface. And then we kept the sample for 3 days and 48 days to allow penetration. Now some interesting results. So we all know that the complex modulus can tell us about the aging of the C4, how the C4 the binder is. And for the RTFO age of mid-age binder, the complex modulus will be always higher. So here the continuous line, blue line, is showing the complex modulus of unaged binder. And when we did the aging, it's the black dot. And then we added, it's the mixing procedure. So when we added this replay, bioresistor, joint bond, and CSS 1H to the aged binder and mix it where we could ensure the 100% blending, we saw that it actually lowered the complex modulus, and for the replay and bioresistor, it even lower than the unaged binder. So it's pretty clear that it was able to reverse the oxidation process. When we use this pipette method, which was more realistic based on how it applies in the field, and it was mostly based on how much it's penetrating over the days, we still saw that it's not that much prominent based on what we saw for the mixing procedure, but still the black dots represents the complex modulus for the RTFO binder, just RTFO H binder without the treatment. So when we applied all those sealants, and we saw that there is a shift towards the softer binder. So it was able to reverse a little bit of this process. Now this is the rotting factor and the fatigue factor. So the top chart is representing the rotting factor. As we can see that the replay and bioresistor is lowering the rotting resistance. However, the CSS is currently performing same as the control, and the joint bond is a little bit lower than the control section. For the fatigue factor, also the Ripley and Biorestore had a very lower fatigue resistance, but the CSS is kind of the same as the control, and the joint bone is a little bit lower. So for the mixing process, the red line, the red column, it's much lower because here we were able to obtain that 100% bending, but that's not the case in the actual field. So this is the result from the wrapping test and the fatigue test. And this is from the low temperature creep stiffness and relaxation properties. So it is interesting to say that this Ripley and Biorestore lowered the creep stiffness and increased the relaxation properties, which is a favorable condition if we want to increase our low temperature cracking. But the CSS 1-inch showed us a stiffening effect, increasing the creep stiffness. And also it has the similar relaxation properties like the control. The joint bone also performed kind of similar, have a significant effect in these low temperature properties of the binder. Now we did this binder grade change, where we saw that for the three different procedures of sample preparation, one is mixing, another one is the perfect method, but after 3 days and after 48 days. So we saw that there's oil-based Ripley and Biorestore actually doesn't help much at the high temperature, but helps the low temperature range because it increases the low temperature range. For the joint bone, it's kind of doesn't help much for the high temperature, but helps a little bit with the low temperature. And CSS 1-inch has a very stiffening effect, and it kind of keeps the same binder grade. And the true binder grade for the PG15-28 is 62-31. So based on that, we did our this grade change analysis. For the piping method, 48 days, we weren't able to get the low temperature grading because it was kind of unrealistic or hard to store the binder beam for like 48 days, because if we keep it in the refrigerator, we will experience some physical hardening, which will not reflect the actual properties. So we just did it for the 3 days. Now the conclusion, the oil-based sealants decreased rotting and fatigue resistance. However, it helped the low temperature grading. The water-based sealant, which is joint bond, and the traditional emulsion, CSS 1-inch, did not bring any significant changes to the binder grade, except that emulsion showed a stiffening effect. It was found that simple mixing procedure produces unrealistic results with significant softening of the treated aged binder, particularly at high temperature. The pipette procedure appears to produce more realistic results. And we will see the correlation with the field performance a little bit later. Now we did the testing on the mixture. So for the mixture, we used bending beam rheometer test that was developed by Marcinio in 2009. We chose this testing method because here we can actually test the binder from every layer of a core, and that will help us to get an idea like how the penetration is going on from layer to layer of a core in the actual field. So we did the testing at two temperatures, and we also did this bending strength test where we break the binder and we recorded the load, how much load it took to break the binder after it was treated with different type of sealants. So for the sample preparation, we use the same sample preparation method, the pipette method that we used for the binder. Here we calculated again based on like how much drops we need to treat the binder based on the surface area and the mixture. Here we obtain the core in the first figure, and then we cut them into four layers: the top layer, middle layer, bottom layer, and the fourth layer. So the top layer is basically that the field treated layer, because that was the layer where the sealants were applied in the field. And then in the middle and bottom layer, our purpose is basically to check like how much it's penetrating and if there is any change in creep stiffness or relaxation properties from layer to layer. At the fourth layer, we applied the sealant in the laboratory in a pipette method using the drops. So the beam dimensions is presented here. And as I said, the sealants were applied at the last layer or the fourth layer in the laboratory so that we can run a comparison from field treated layer versus lab treated layer. So here are some test results from the creep stiffness. And we performed the testing at minus 24 and minus 12 degrees Celsius But here I'm just presenting the results from minus 24 degrees Celsius. So the top chart is representing the results from top treated layer. So this is the layer which is the field treated. And the bottom is the lab treated where we applied the sealants in the lab on the binder beads. As you can see that there is not much significant changes observed in the field treated layer. It might be because it was applied spraying, so it might not get the that point the application rate. But when we applied it in the lab, it was more controlled and in a controlled environment, so we could see our significant changes from sealant, and we could run a comparison. As we saw with the binder, the CSS has a little bit of stiffening effect, and then the oil-based replay and bioester had a lot more softening effect in terms of stiffness in the lab. Also for the strength at minus 24 degrees Celsius, it was observed that for the field treated, they performed kind of same. However, the CSS has a little bit higher strength and the bioester as well. For the lab treated layer, they are kind of all over the place, but the replay has a really lower strength compared to the control section. So from here, we can see that it's a little bit also more significant changes in the lab rather than in the field. Here is the percent strain at failure at minus 24 degrees Celsius. So as we saw that this oil-based rejuvenator has a steep softening effect, it has higher strain at failure. But those are really insignificant when you tested the top layer on the field treated layer. But it was more significant, the changes in the lab. So then we tried to look at the results from layer to layer. So here are some plots that after 3 weeks and after 8 weeks. So how does it look if we analyze top layer versus middle layer and versus bottom layer? So these are the top three layers, which might help us to get an idea like how much it's penetrating. For the contour, as we can see, like after 3 weeks, as expected, the bottom layer has lower creep stiffness because the top layers experience more aging. After 8 weeks, they're kind of the similar. With the replay, after 3 weeks, there is no significant changes among the layers, but after 8 months, there is a lower in the top layer. So after analyzing from all the treated section, we saw that the coefficient of variation among the layers is very low. So we actually combine all three layers for the further comparison. So here each curve is representing the average of three replicates. So when we combine the top three layers, we are basically took the average of 9 replicates. And here is the idea, and here is the results what we got after the comparison. So after 3 weeks and after 8 months, for the contour, as we expected, that the creep stiffness increased. For the replay and bioester, it was kind of interesting to see that after 8 months, you can see a little bit effect of lowering creep stiffness. And for the relaxation properties, it's actually increasing the relaxation properties, which is more favorable for low temperature cracking. And for the CSS, we can see a very high stiffening effect. And it increased the creep stiffness and also lowered the relaxation properties. So when we combine this failure, we can actually see the difference in the field treated layers. This is the formula strength. So for the strength, we can see that this is kind of all over the place, but it's still replay and bioester, though it increased the stiffness. It has a lower strength. That when I say the strength, it means that it took less load to break the binder compared to the other treated section. But it has percent strain, higher percent strain at failure. So the findings from the mixture testing, the application of sealants in the field resulted only significant statistical changes, only few, but there was a lot of changes, significant changes in the field and the lab treated beams. However, when considering all the beams from top 3 layers, we saw some changes which adjusted with the laboratory testing. Overall, the application of oil-based biosealants had a softening effect observed from the reduction in creep stiffness associated with an increase in M value. Aging effect after 8 months, while the creep stiffness of the control section increased, the oil-based sealants treated section resulted in lower creep stiffness than after the 3 weeks and compared to the control section as well. Now we did some FTIR analysis since we didn't see any significant changes when we just considered the field treated layer. And so we extracted the binder. Binder was extracted from pre-treated layer and the laboratory treated layer. And there was no trace of sealant observed in the pre-treated layer. However, the sealants were observed to be presented in the lab treated layer. So that kind of also matches the field and the laboratory evaluation from our study. Here is some correlation between field performance. This is the figure I showed initially, that the canvas prepping. So the right axis is presenting binder prep stiffness at minus 18 degrees Celsius at 67. So here I have presented two sample preparation method. One is the mixing and another is the pipette method. So here it's kind of match the trend, like with the lower prep stiffness, you expect low transverse prepping. And when we compare the crack growth rate with the change in stiffness, we saw that compared with the control, we saw the highest softening effect in replay and the highest stiffening effect in CSS1H, the traditional sealant. And also when we check the crack growth rate in the field, we also saw that the highest crack growth rate was observed in the replay treated section and also in the CSS1H treated section. So the trend of the laboratory findings and the field findings matches, because the highest effect was found in the replay and the CSS1H. So it can be assumed that the significant stiffening and significant softening both might be detrimental to the pavement. FTIR analysis supported the laboratory results by showing the presence of sealants only on the laboratory treated samples. Field investigation, replay and CSS1H treated sections resulted in the highest transverse crack growth rate. Both laboratory treated beams and field treated beams resulted in the lowest prep stiffness due to application of replay and the highest prep stiffness due to application of CSS1H. So the key findings. The key findings is it is essential to have an idea about the sealant performance in terms of excessive stiffening and softening before we apply it in the field. Oil-based sealants are a manager increased rotting and fatigue resistance. However, help the low temperature grading. Oil-based sealant treated binder and mixture exhibit a softening effect, whereas traditional emulsion shows stiffening effect. A sample preparation method was developed which can closely mimic the sealant application in the field. Bending beam rheometer was observed to have the potential to distinguish among the performance of the different types of sealants, which correlated well with the field performance. So that's kind of the key findings from the study. And thank you. Any questions?
We're going to open it up to questions now. So if anybody's got questions either online or on the phone, just shout them out. Anybody here too? Bernard?
Yeah, I have a question. Very interesting presentation, by the way. Well, probably because I'm not deeply into asphalt. I was into asphalt when I was a soils stroke materials engineer in those days in the district. But I've been in concrete for a long time now.
We can't hear that person very well.
Is there a microphone?
Yeah. Yes. Can you talk closer to the mic here?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I was just saying that I really admire the presentation, and an aspect that I will be asking based on my knowledge of concrete, the bending beam rheometer. It seems to be a point load at mid-span. Now, if you look at, the reason why we run away from point load at mid-span in concrete is because at that, under that loading configuration, you cannot really distinguish between a flexural failure and a shear failure, because the peak, you know, if failure occurs, it will either be one of the two, and you cannot guarantee which it is. So is the bending beam rheometer based on, is it evaluating stiffness on the basis of bending or on the basis of shear? What exactly does it use, or is it a combination of, what's the theory behind using that loading configuration?
The bending beam, the 3-point bending beam rheometer is, so when we applied it, this testing for the mixture, are you talking about mixture or the binder?
Well, I saw you use the bending beam rheometer. I saw a picture of it. I was concerned about the point load at mid-span.
Yeah.
Is that a point load or is it?
It's a point load.
Okay.
So So it's based on the bending.
Yeah. I was asking about the mechanics of that kind of loading configuration. What do you really want from it? And what's the theory behind it?
So the bending limiter, it's actually telling you that so when we run it here at the 240 seconds, it actually gives you an idea of what happens in 2 hours when it's in a low temperature. So it kind of captures the stiffening effect. So you apply this 1 newton load for 120 seconds, and then you relax it. So how much deflection? So you then calculate the stiffness based on that that corresponding deflection for the load. So it's the.
So it's not a test of destruction.
No.
Okay.
No, it's not a destructive test.
Okay.
Yeah. So you just calculate how much is deflecting for that elapse of time.
Thank you.
Any more questions from our online group? I don't think there are. Any more questions here?
No, but I'd like to thank everyone for attending our seminar today, and we'll see you again in October.
Thank you very much.